In multi-view projections, as its name indicates, a number of projections or views at different angles are obtained on different planes like this, preferably front view, top view and side view. So here we are considering three planes. So this is the vertical plane and this is the horizontal plane and this is the profile plane. And here this is the object in space. So we are getting the front view like this on the vertical plane, top view on the horizontal plane like this. So this is only the top view, this is the front view, and the side view are getting on the profile plane like this. So this is the side view. So here the orientation of the object in space is such that we have to get the true shape of the object rather than the 3D shape of the object. Here see, this is only a cube. So when you look in this direction, then you will get the front view. That front view is only a square like this. So that square you will get here on the vertical plane. And when you look in this direction, this is also a square, and that you will get on this plane. It's only the profile plane. And when you look from the top, this is the top view. This is the top view, and you will get the top view on the horizontal plane. So in all these views, you see, you will get the true size and shape of the object. It's only a square, this also a square, and here also it's a square. That means you will get the true shape of the object. But none of these views will give an idea about the 3D shape of the object. Actually, it's a cube, no? But in front view, you won't get an idea about the that 3D shape. In side view also you won't get an idea about the 3D shape. Here also you won't get an idea about the 3D shape. So this is only multi-view projection. Now we will consider the projections of two objects. One is a cube like this and the other one a square prism like this. When you consider the projections of these two objects in this direction, you will get only squares. So for this cube, when you project it in this direction, you will get a cube like this. And this is a square prism. And when you project this cube, this prism in this direction, the same square you will get. So for both these cases, you are getting the squares only. That means you are not getting an idea about the 3D shape of the object. So to get an idea about the 3D shape of the object, either you have to tilt the solid like this and you have to get the projection, or you have to go for a number of projections at different angles, preferably front view, top view and side view. For example, if you are considering this as the front view, now what about the top view? Top view means you had to look in this direction. So this is only the top view of that cube. So it's again a square. So this is only the top view. Then when you consider the side view, say one of the side views you consider, that's also a square. So you are getting three projections in this case. Now in this case, this is a top. This is a top view. So it's only a rectangle like this. That's only this one. And when you consider the side view, so either you draw this one or this one. So if you are considering the side view, it's again a rectangle like this. So in this case it is a front view, this is a top view and side view. For the cube it's a front view and this is a top view and this is a side view. See, I have drawn three different views, but to get an idea about the 3D shape of the object, here only two views are required. That is, if you are getting only this front view and top view, you will get an idea about the shape of the 3D shape of the object. That means if you are getting the front view and the top view, you will get some idea about the 3D shape of the object. Here also, if you are getting two views, you can get an idea about the 3D shape of the object. That means to get an idea about the 3D shape of the object, a minimum of two views are required. And mainly and preferably that views are front view and top view. But you know, front view means this view and top view means this view, and these two views are at 90 degree apart, and for each view you have to consider a plane. So if you want to get the front view, you have to consider a plane, and if you want to get the top view, then also you have to consider a plane. So as the front view and the top view are at 90 degree apart, the planes you are considering also will be at 90 degree apart. That means you have to consider two planes in the space. They are at 90 degree apart. So these two planes will divide the universe into four quadrants. So when you consider first plane, say like this, then it will divide the universe into upper half and lower half. And when you consider second plane, say a vertical plane, it will divide the universe into this half and this half. So these two planes in the universe will divide the entire volume into four quadrants. So let this be that planes. They are only imaginary planes, that means they are transparent. So let this be the first plane and let this be the second plane. So these planes will divide the universe into four quadrants. So this is considered as the first quadrant, then this as the second quadrant, this as the third quadrant and this as the fourth quadrant. Now we will consider the particle again. Here we have considered two planes like this, and these planes will divide the universe into four quadrants. So this is the first quadrant, this is the second quadrant, this is the third quadrant and this is the fourth quadrant. So first, second, third and fourth in anti-clockwise direction. Now you consider that particle in space. Let this be that particle. So this is that particle, and now we have to get the projections of this particle on these reference planes. So to get the projection of this particle on this plane, you have to project this particle like this. So when you project, you will get it like this. So here you will get the 2D shape of this particle. So this is only that 2D shape of the particle on the vertical plane. And what about the projection on the horizontal plane? That you will get like this. So here you will get So this is only the top view of this particle. So this is the front view and this is the top view. So this is the front view. Front view and this is the top view. This is a front view and this is a top view. So after getting the projections of this particle on the respective plane, now we can remove this particle, because you know, these particle, these projections now will represent this particle. Now, after getting the projections on the respective plane, there is no use of this actual object, because now these projections will represent this actual object. And for further reference, we can use these projections. So there is no use of this thing, so we can throw it away. Now, why you have converted that 3D shape to 2D shapes like this? I mean, the projections on vertical plane and horizontal plane, because you cannot draw that 3D shape directly on the plane of the board. So that is why, by using the concept of projection, you have converted that into 2D shapes like this. So you are getting the projections on the vertical and horizontal planes like this. So that 3D shape is now converted to 2D shape. Now you can draw that on the plane of the board. But now the problem is not with the object, but with the arrangement of these planes, because these two planes are mutually perpendicular and it is three-dimensional. That means you cannot draw this arrangement of the planes directly on the plane of the board. That means by some means you have to convert this into a two-dimensional arrangement. So the question is, how it is possible? So this can be done by relatively rotating these planes. That means, keeping one of the planes stationary, you have to rotate the second plane. For example, if you are keeping this vertical plane stationary, you have to rotate this plane, that is the horizontal plane, in such a way that it has to coincide with the vertical plane. So either you can rotate this plane in this direction or in the opposite direction, that is in clockwise direction or in anti-clockwise direction. But if somebody is rotating in clockwise direction and if another person is rotating in anti-clockwise direction, the answer won't be same. That means all of us has to follow the same rule. That is why we are rotating this horizontal plane in such a way that the first and the third quadrant will be opened and the second and fourth quadrant will be closed. So either you can keep this vertical plane stationary or horizontal plane stationary. If you are keeping vertical plane stationary, you have to rotate this plane, I mean the horizontal plane, in this direction, so that these two quadrants, that is first and third quadrant, should be opened and second and fourth should be closed. Or if you are maintaining this one, I mean the horizontal plane stationary, you have to rotate this plane, that is the vertical plane, in this direction, so that first and third again will be opened and second and fourth will be closed. So let this be the vertical and that horizontal plane. This is the first quadrant, this is the second quadrant, this is the third quadrant, and this is the fourth quadrant. So now, keeping this plane stationary, I'm going to rotate this plane. So it will be like this. So this first quadrant and third quadrant are opened, and second and fourth are closed. So like this. Finally, these two planes will coincide and you will get a single plane. So now these are the projections of that particle. We are getting the front view of the particle here and top view of the particle here. This is the front view and this is the top view. After getting these projections, you have to throw the actual particle or actual object away. Now, when you rotate these planes relatively to make them a single plane, it will be like this. So both the planes will coincide like this and you will get a single plane. Now, you can draw, or you can, yeah, you can draw both these planes on the board like this, or you can consider both the planes on the board like this. Now these planes are transparent, it is of infinite size, so there is no boundary. So after getting the planes on this plane of the board, it will be like this. So both HP and VP are there on the board, because these two planes, that is HP and VP, are transparent and they are of infinite size. So you cannot draw the boundary of these planes. So now these two planes are there on the board. It will coincide with the plane of the board. But in a drawing, you have to get an idea about the shape, size, and position of the object. That is why you are defining these two planes. In mathematics, we are defining x and y coordinate system, xy coordinate system, so that you can fix a point in two dimension. And here, to fix the point in space, we can use these two planes, because everything in the universe are moving. So you have to consider two imaginary planes like this in the universe, so that we can assume that these planes are fixed. And now we can fix the position of this point or that particle. So if this is that particle, you can mark the position by marking the distance from the reference planes. So this is the distance from the vertical plane, and this is the distance from the horizontal plane. And now after the rotation, now both these planes are coinciding with the plane of the board. Now the question is, how you will mark the position of that object on this board? Because you are getting the front view like this and top view like this. You cannot mark the position of this object or that particle. So in this case, we will make an assumption. That is, the line of intersection of these two planes is visible. That means these are the two planes, and this is the line of intersection. You know, these planes are of infinite size, so definitely the length of this line of intersection is also infinity. So if it is visible after the rotation of these two planes, these planes are transparent. Now you can see only this line, that's the line of intersection. That means when you draw these two planes on the board, line of intersection of these two planes is visible. So it will be like this. But its length is infinity. So it is infinity. Now we can mark the position of these projections on the board. So either you have to draw an arrow mark like this to show that the line is of infinite length, or you have to mark, or you have to name it as XY. Now it is like this, both HP and VP are coinciding like this, and the line of intersection is visible. That means to prepare a drawing, the projections of an object on the board or on a sheet of paper, you have to draw XY first. So now the question is, what is the meaning of XY? Now to understand the concept of XY, we will consider these three cases. Here I am considering a small ball like this or a sphere like this. When you project it on this plane, you will get the front view. And when you project it on this plane, you will get the top view. So after getting these projections on the respective planes, you have to relatively rotate these planes so that these planes has to coincide each other. Then you will get the projections like this. That is, the planes will coincide like this, and you will get front view and top view like this, and this is the XY. That means this much volume in space is now represented by these two areas on this plane. Or when you draw this thing on the board, now these two planes are on the plane of the board, and now these two areas on the plane or plane of the board will now represent this volume in space. Now we consider this arrangement. In this I am considering a medium sized ball. When you project it towards this plane, you will get the projection of this ball on this plane. So it is like this. When you project it downward, you will get the top view of the ball. It is like this. So you will get the front view and top view like this. So after getting the projections on this respective planes, here also you have to relatively rotate these planes so that they will coincide each other. And now it will be like this. Both HP and VP are coinciding like this, and you are getting the front view and top view like this. And when you draw both these planes on the board, it will be like this. That means you are getting the projections of this ball on the plane of the board. Now these two areas will represent this much volume in space. Actually, this volume is in space, and these two areas will represent this much volume in space. Now you consider a relatively big volume like this. So in this case also you have to project on the respective planes. So when you project on vertical plane, you will get this as the front view, and when you project it downward, you will get this as the top view. So after getting the projections on the respective planes, here also you have to relatively rotate the planes so that they have to coincide each other, and you will get the projections like this, and the planes will coincide each other. And when you draw these planes on the plane of the board, it will be like this. That means these two areas now will represent this much volume in space. Now you consider that quadrants in space. Instead of these spheres in space, now you consider the entire first quadrant. So this is the first quadrant. Now you project that entire volume of the first quadrant towards the vertical plane. So you will get a two-dimensional area on the vertical plane. And similarly, you project it downward so that you will get the top view of this entire first quadrant on the horizontal plane. So after getting the projections on the respective planes, you have to relatively rotate these planes so that they have to coincide each other. And then you will get like this. After the rotation, because you are getting the front view of this entire quadrant on this plane and the top view of entire quadrant on this plane. So this area that is above this XY will represent the front view of this entire first quadrant. Similarly, the top view you are getting on the horizontal plane. So after the rotation, it will be like this. Area behind below XY will represent the top view of this entire first quadrant. Now you consider the second quadrant. This is the second quadrant. When you project the entire second quadrant towards the vertical plane, you will get the front view of the second quadrant on the vertical plane like this. And top view of the entire second quadrant you will get on this plane. After getting these two projections, you have to relatively rotate these planes so that these planes will coincide each other and you will get a single plane. And if XY is visible, then so this area that is above XY will represent the front view and top view of the second quadrant. Similarly, you have to consider the third quadrant. To get the front view, you have to project towards the vertical plane. So first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant. So to get the front view, you have to project towards the vertical plane, and to get the top view, you have to project in the upward direction. So after getting the projections, again you have to relatively rotate these two planes so that the planes will coincide, and finally you will get both the planes on the plane of the board. Now this third quadrant will be like this. This will be the top view of the third quadrant and this will be the front view of the third quadrant. Similarly, you consider the fourth quadrant. When you project the fourth quadrant towards the vertical plane, you will get the projection of that fourth quadrant on the vertical plane. And to get the top view of the entire fourth quadrant, you have to project it in the upward direction. So you'll get the front view on the vertical plane and top view on the horizontal plane. So after relatively rotating these two planes, you will get the projections on the board. Like this. So this area. So area below XY now will represent the front view and top view of the fourth quadrant. So these are the projections of all these four quadrants. Here you will get the projection of the first quadrant, that is front view above and top view below. This is a second quadrant, both front view and top view above XY. Here it's a third quadrant, front view below XY and top view above XY. And fourth quadrant, both front view and top view below XY. Now if you are considering all these quadrants together, that means the entire universe together, then we can draw it like this. That means area above XY and below XY will represent the entire universe. The universe is in 3D form. Here you are getting it in 2D form. That means the entire universe is now on the board, but it is in the 2D form. So when you draw XY on a drawing sheet, to prepare a drawing, the meaning is the entire universe is now coming on the plane of that board or plane of the sheet. And actually that small sphere or that medium sphere or that big sphere, all these are in the universe only. Now you can say a car or a ship or any object in space, it will be only in this universe. So you have to only mark that area here. If that small sphere is there, you can mark that area here, because that small sphere is in the universe, entire universe is on the board, so you can mark that small sphere like this. When you consider medium sphere, that much volume is also there in the universe, so already that universe is there on the board, so you can mark that volume of the medium sphere like this. And that is the meaning of XY. So when you draw XY on a sheet of paper to prepare a drawing, actually the entire universe is coming on the board or on the sheet of that paper. But without marking XY, it's only a mere line. That means if somebody is drawing a drawing like this, without marking XY, if he is simply drawing a line like this to represent that line, there is no meaning. It's only a mere line segment.